Children and Families Overview and Screening Committee. Are you all going to begin? First of all, I'd like to welcome Chris Penn, who is the Cardiff member for Diocese of Chester, which is the first meeting, so welcome to you. At the briefing session, I'm conscious that we have an item which is feedback from the Borough Safeguarding Children's Board, and I was hoping to move that to just after item 6, because David Robbins will be taking item 6 and he's the manager of the board, and he might be able to give us a bit of feedback and answer some of your questions and comments around the workshop. So it's all right with the committee. I'd like to move item 11 to be taken just after item 6, and then we'll be there to all of So I have apologies for absence for Brian Kenny, Jean Stapleton, Murray McLaughlin and Julie Johnson, who have been on the board, Diocese of Shrewsbury. And standing in for them as deputies would be Councillor Julie McManus, Ari Williams and Anita Lee. So thank you, Margaret. Any more apologies?
I'm deputised for Adam Sykes.
Are there any declarations of interest?
Just by virtue of my employment within the Department for Work Professions.
Of who's got responsibility at the local level. seat on, that's okay. I'm afraid you'll find it comes very small, so I'm just going to put in the general direction of the picture, and it's sort of different departments add in as we go, so bear me a second. So you don't need to read what's on it, but all other than to say, anything in the top left-hand corner is based as a force level, a force level footprint. Anything in the bottom left-hand corner has got local footprints, and I'll talk through what they are. So this first element is what we call response and resolution. This is our emergency response. So they're now basically the four hubs across the whole of Merseyside, Walsley being one of those hubs. They can respond to 999 calls 24/7 anywhere in Merseyside. The reality of that is, rural patrols generally stay in the rural. And in fact, because of the volume of calls, more patrols come from Liverpool to us than we go from this side over there, because they can draw resources in from those and set them for areas anyway. This element is our investigation element, and this has got a partial footprint at force level around our protecting vulnerable people. We have an analytical capability that sits at the centre, and then we also have local delivery. You're never going to get away from the fact you've got to investigate crimes at a local level. So a part of the presentation from previously, I indicated when I first became a detective, the bread and butter work was your burglaries, your robberies, your what we call auto crime offences. Actually, that's changed. The time of smaller elements was the areas around domestic abuse. They are now the main areas, the areas around protecting the vulnerable. They are the core bread and butter work now of the CID. And actually, the burglaries and robberies are to a lesser extent in volume wise. And of course, risk as well around vulnerability. This element here is what we call matrix. This has got our public order response. So sometimes you see sort of either in Birkenhead or Liverpool, you'll see some of the carriers driving around, the police carriers. And it's also got our firearms capability, our roads policing capability, dogs in there. They're a force resource. Some of you may be aware that we had a couple of firearms discharges recently in the Wallasey area. Thankfully, that's not a common occurrence on the Wirral. And in the time I've been here in command of the resources, we've had two separate incidents. We had two discharges within a day of each other, which is what occurred recently, targeting the same properties. I think they got one back the first time, came back. And then the other occasion happened following the tragic death of the young male down right in front of some retaliation involved in there, which was publicised. So those aren't common occurrences, certainly in comparison to Liverpool. But when we get those type of incidents, we're looking at what resources we can call in from elsewhere around the force. So on the back of a firearms discharge, we've got additional armed response vehicles able to come over here for disruptive activity, and that's where they come from. This is my area of command in the bottom left-hand corner, and this is the local policing contingent, which is split into two areas. We've got the community policing elements, which is what you probably termed your neighbourhood officers, includes your local policing officers who are involved in problem solving, dealing with social behaviour, things that are impacting vulnerable people. Our police community support officers are based in that contingent. I also have about 75 staff involved in what's called the targeting policing team. They are a central resource that I can use to track down fugitives, to execute search warrants, to carry out searches, to a manner of different things. They're the ones who drive around in the fast cars, which have got the automatic plate recognition technology on them, you know, in tunnel operations, etc., etc., etc. So they're the proactive element that I have. And obviously, I move them around the rural area, depending on what the risks are within the rural areas at one time. And then finally, sort of sitting on top of that side, we've got our force intelligence function, which does have a small local footprint and helps support the work that we're doing locally. And relation to the other side, I'll just pen those out. We've got a number of other things going on in the organisation that are looking at how efficient and effective we are, what opportunities there are around collaboration, etc. So the left-hand side is predominantly the operational response within the office. So I've been asked obviously to discuss what sort of safeguarding looks like at the local level and how we deal with it. And we have a small analytical research and analytical capability based at Wallasey that gathers information from a lot of different data sets each week, looking at people, young people who go missing, looking at particular types of offences on the vulnerable, and they might be sex offences, they might be domestic abuse, that might be drugs related, criminal exploitation of young people taking place, and they produce a document that helps inform our weekly operational meeting, where we have certain partners that actually become part of that meeting, and I use the resources to target activity on a week-by-week basis. The second element of that is in relation to the top miss for children. It mentions their, acronyms, I keep forgetting the police example acronyms. Local policing areas on the top line, protecting vulnerable people, and research and analysis. Miss the missing person, and what we do, we have a central governance meeting, which I'll get to in a moment, but we look at across the force, wide picture, people who are going missing, young people going missing, and the volume at which they're going missing. And the reason we do that is we've very quickly become alive to making sure that you haven't got an unconscious bias whereby a young 14-year-old female who probably a girl who is not attending school is out late at night, hanging around with older males, and actually, do you get the same response when that individual is reported missing? Because an officer may go and they may say, actually, this is not girl's school, why has she been missing that many times? What sort of risk is she under? Is actually, she's been either sexually exploited, potentially criminally exploited. And so it's ensuring that when we look at those case studies, that there's been a consistent response across the organisation, whether the call going to our call centre, whether local policing pick it up, and to make sure that we're addressing things appropriately and at the right level. Then finally, we look at specific case studies, and that's LPA, is local policing area. Threat, harm, risk is the threat and the risk of harm to individuals. What we look at is, and I've presented in other forums, where we show from quite basic to very complex association charts that we are using by overlaying data that we have got and we've gathered from partners. So as an example, we might identify, and we have done, a small, relatively small group that live in a particular area on the Wirral, and they are aged, they're males aged sort of 13 to 16 years old, and they're either on fringe of criminality, involved in social behaviour, or actually have been arrested for dealing drugs. And it's easy from a police response to be very sort of linear in your response and put them straight into the criminal justice system. And actually what we're trying to get a better understanding of is actually, are they victims themselves and being exploited? And we've got examples of older people in their 30s and 40s sitting above that younger cohort that we would use the term, they have given us a graft phone, so they've given us a phone with a particular number on it. This phone is held by these young people. They to and fro to particular properties to go and retrieve drugs and go and do drugs deals, take the money back. They're constantly turning over that work. When they've done their stint, that graft phone goes to someone else and they carry on. So your drug dependent individual is just phoning one number, and obviously they are managing and exploiting the individuals to deal with. Some of you may have heard of the term called County Lines, and that's it's a nationally recognised term regarding the exploitation of people, and it's prevalent in your big cities, sort of comes from Merseyside, Manchester, cities in Yorkshire, and actually that's about exploiting individuals and sending them out into less urban areas, like Cumbria, maybe some areas of Lancashire, into North Wales. They're just using that graft further elsewhere, and their reach has become more extensive. You may have picked up on the news from last week. We executed 17 warrants on the Wirral as a result of an operation that's been led by our regional organised crime group called Titan. They are a regional unit that each of the six regional police forces puts resources into. That operation has dismantled a particular, what we call organised crime group, a recognised group of people that know each other. It might be through families, it might be through associations that are very organised about the distribution of drugs on a local or further afield. Now that particular organised crime group was based locally, was ruling the area with fear, no one was reported on them. And actually, you know, they had graft runs in Bristol, in Milton Keynes. You know, so those are the sort of distances of, you know, people being exploited. Now, 14 individuals, as is the number that were arrested, have actually been remanded into custody. And I was explaining before, just to demonstrate the type of people that we're dealing with. You know, one individual not declaring any income to Revenue and Customs, has put £1.8 million through online gambling and managed to win £1.7 million back. So, just I think demonstrates the sort of volumes that we're talking about and the type of exploitation that we're talking about, and that's an answer to safeguarding people. Okay, so I sort of spoke about what's the government's process to try and give some reassurance about what we're doing. I mentioned a couple of things already. Each month, there is a series of meetings that come together. It's a fourth level with representation across all the local authority areas. Usually at either my level or chief inspector, certainly have a CID representation at detective chief inspector at it. And we go through the case studies. One of the areas we look at is the sexual exploitation of individuals, criminal exploitation, harmful practices around forced marriage, FGM, that type of thing. And then the other side of things, we look at how we're targeting registered sex offenders. We look at where sex offences are committed against vulnerable people. Obviously domestic abuse and the impact of domestic abuse within a family setting. I mentioned county lines there. Before, another thing that's termed, you may have heard of, is called cookery. And this is where a vulnerable individuals who are targeted, who have got access to properties, so they may have a housing allowance or whatever, but they're vulnerable in themselves. So other people target them to store drugs, guns, use their houses as parties, forever to and fro, because obviously those people who are using that graft phone are not going back to their own address to get those drugs. They've got hives all over the place, and often it's within vulnerable individuals' properties. Now, we've used legislation in the last 6 months where we have the power to exclude people from properties dependent on what evidence we gather. And that's where we work closely with the Wirral Social Behaviour Team, and we look at what we can actually get in statement form, but also what we can get back off diary sheets, what we can pick up off our incident logs, and we overlay all that information to put into a civil court environment to say, on the balance, we need to provide some protection around this particular location. So again, we're just trying to target the vulnerable and make children within that particular environment. So our response is based on what we call 4 P's, and this is emanated from the counter-terrorism strategy, moved into serious and organised crime strategy, and obviously the 4 P's are headed there under pursue, preventing, attack and repair. Pursue very much, I suppose, historically, how the police would be perceived around interventions, locking people up and getting them in the criminal justice system. But I like to think that we've moved on a little bit since then. We work effectively with partners, obviously we're in schools, we look at a variety of legislation, we look at trying to educate people and get involved, we look at trying to dismantle groups to prevent the negative role models, and we look at supporting those that are vulnerable. Very much working together, because we need to have an understanding of the demand that we're creating for the partners and partners are creating for us, where that fits into and what can be delivered on individuals' threshold of needs. So at the very top end, cases will be referred into MASH, and obviously there will be work wrapped around that, around how we can protect those vulnerable people. But more locally, we've had delivery of training to our police community support officers, frontline local policing officers, so they know when they go into specific environments, family settings, they can pick up on issues that might be affecting the children within those environments, and they can make appropriate referrals through that will enable some level of early help to be involved, so people don't end up going down to criminality or you know, a number of other impact factors that might happen that affect their life chances. I sort of mentioned obviously the operational response on some of the agencies that we're involved with. As a separate piece of work, I lead on early for the force around how we are applying our early help work across all the boroughs across the Merseyside, and Deborah in particular and other colleagues have been to workshops that we've coordinated to try and see where partners have got a wider footprint than just a particular local authority area. How do we try and standardise some of that approach and understand the demands on each other when particular issues are being raised? So, for example, if the Wirral wants to introduce a particular deferral form, we've got officers coming over from Merseyside to answer, from Liverpool to answer jobs over here, so we need to understand what that's going to be. So I've also got a couple of staff who helped me with that piece of work, sitting on the National Early Health Foundation, Early Intervention Foundation rather. We've dedicated to the local level six police community support officers into the Safer Wirral Hub, and they are being used to problem solve cases that get identified as being appropriate to try and tackle some of the issues. And target some of the needs of young people at an earlier stage. As I mentioned, Tracy Hayes, superintendent, has been seconded into the project, which is obviously coming to fruition as of the launch on the 10th of October. I think that's probably it, really, about the Safer Wirral Hub. Just a couple of things to sort of take away there. We obviously need the information to respond, and some people are in fear of providing information, some people are unsure or don't want to bother about providing information because they're not quite sure, but what they've seen is at a particular level that they should report it, or they're not quite sure where to report it. So we really are encouraging use of Crime Stoppers for those people who don't feel they've got an appropriate reporting mechanism or they're in fear of reprisals, and obviously I would ask you this, if you take anything away from here, to encourage people to use that number. It's been around for quite a long period of time. There's going to be a new marketing campaign around it. People can get rewards from it as well if information is used, and obviously leads to convictions or the disruption of particular cases. Yeah, I think that's about it really from an information point of view. So probably just to sort of summarise and say that we recognise that the issues around safeguarding are not solely a police issue, they're the wider partnership issues. It really is at the forefront of our mind, and we work together on training now to make sure we've got a consistent approach. We recognise the demands we place on the statutory level. And we're trying to build a framework to get in and become involved far earlier to influence the life chances of children and young people.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you, Superintendent, for that very extensive report. I'd like to raise an issue regarding grass culture, which is something that you touched upon, and how it's quite embedded in Wirral. I feel as if that's selling to our young people. They don't feel as if that they can contact the police, and I think it's very important that we reiterate the fact that they can contact Crime Stoppers and do welcome the marketing campaign that we hope to see soon. An issue that I'd like to raise is regarding vulnerable people and young people selling drugs in Wirral. Something that I've noticed certainly in my ward in New Ferry is that for some reason, most recently, the people who are selling drugs have got younger. It's almost as if that the people who are creating the drugs want to target your 12, your 11 and your 13-year-olds so they can sell it in schools. And I am aware that, and I'd certainly like to arrange a meeting with you separate to this meeting, of schools where drugs are being sold in schools and schools are aware of it and they're not reporting it to the police out of fear of their reputation. And I think it comes back to the amount of scrutiny within our schools. Academisation has kind of pulled that away, and I do feel that schools are seen to be protective over their reputation compared to the fact that we've got really vulnerable people in schools selling drugs. So I would like to give you a sentence to this, and I just want to raise the issue regarding the Crime Stoppers too. Thank you for that.
Well, just in response, we have had within Wirral some difficulties sort of back in the last year and the beginning part of this year, particularly around the availability of ecstasy, which is probably a slightly separate issue to the drug dealing people, so as a letterhead on street conversion people, and I'll come back to that. We've had some multi-agency coordination meetings, and we're very much linking through the school's office to public health, and we've had representatives of the schools from the Wirral involved on the back of concerns being raised about the prevalence of ecstasy. Now that was running alongside obviously the Titan operation, and part of that operation, whilst building the case over 18 months, recognised throughout it there were some elements of the operation where action needed to be taken to safeguard vulnerable people. And an example is, earlier in the year, we've identified a potential pill factory in American Head. So rather than leave it because we didn't want to disrupt the operation, we dealt with that in isolation, executed the warrant, and we recovered a significant amount of drugs and the pill machine, which is capable of over 5,000 pills an hour. So that sort of demonstrates the sort of potential prevalence of tablets that actually children are buying a quarter tablet for £2.
Yeah.
You know, that's the sort of level they're paying. And because they don't know what's in it, and they don't know it's down to the real physiology, there's actually one individual can take it and not feel any effects, the next individual can take it and keel over and collapse. And we were obviously having a reported increase of young people around 14 years of age presenting at the emergency department. And so we became involved very much with the schools to try and educate and get it. And we did make some arrests of children who were attending those schools. And obviously, the operation last week is obviously much higher at the scale. So we're not sitting on our laurels, is what I'm saying. But at the moment, we've realised that being a problem does something about it. And I know personally, I have not seen children in schools on the wheel. As part of newsletters, I've seen education coming out to parents, which I know is what we fed in with public health in the first place. So I'm quite reassured that the schools are taking it on board and raising it, although obviously I'm probably the best place to scrutinise the schools around their response. Mm-hmm. Just in relation to the other issue with regards to young people actually dealing, you know, from the police perspective, we need information, we need intelligence to respond to it. But we've got a finite amount of resource, and we've got a lot of things to deal with. And when we take out particularly what we call street level dealers, it creates a vacuum for a moment and someone fills. And that's the challenge that we face. And part of the work around the Safer Wirral Hub and working with the likes of the Hive and you know, all sorts of groups that give us that sort of contact with younger people, is trying to educate and trying to prevent them from getting more towards the statutory end of intervention. So we will deal with and we will respond to intelligence. And you know, I meet a number of councillors around the loo and MPs, and you know, sometimes it feels like I'm in a revolving door, and they tell me about a road and we've done 5 hours in that road and actually we still haven't gone, do you know what I mean? And,
yeah.
And we've got all this couch hopping going on where no one's actually staying there or paying rent. They're all bridging meters and they're jumping between different houses. And so that's why you'll probably notice some days and actions in some of the wards where we're trying to get all sorts of agencies involved. We get skips in, we're trying to make the environment a better place, you know, particularly around some of the alligating areas and particularly the run up to the likes of Operation Banger, we cause around bonfire night and you know, some of the arsons that we get and you know, that type of thing. So we're trying to deal with those sort of things and be proactive, but of course, as I said, you know, we haven't got resources to be everywhere, we've not some prioritised on our work based on vulnerability and threats to people.
One of the things that you mentioned before is, I think what concerns me is these younger people who are going out, because I know you have an old, you know, that they're doing loans for the drug dealers, and basically they're like being groomed, aren't they, these younger people, and they themselves are victims. So when you get these young people, do you educate them and explain to them that they are actually victims?
Yeah, the danger is, and I think historically the police have probably dealt with things as an intervention, and you know, often, you know, at one level, not necessarily always directly into the criminal justice system, but you know, it might be through obviously youth offending team and services they provide, but more now through the partners we get involved in trying to provide education to them at an earlier stage, and you know, we funded the likes of some of the plays that have been seen in the schools that you know that impact that sort of give those that real hard hitting. This is the impact of sexual exploitation or criminal exploitation. Obviously, last year we had 750 children. We got on buses and took them all down to the floor up within for the ASB play board. It's called, wasn't it? And yeah, the impact of that. And so you know, they take a lot of planning. And we are involved on a constant basis and trying to work, you know, from our local policing teams with the different sort of early health hubs that are involved through social care, children's services. We don't always get it right, you know, as you know, there's cases that, you know, I'm sure you can raise where you go, actually, that fell through the net. And it's those things that need escalated so that we can try and address them and make sure they're not a systemic problem that we're involved with, because we haven't got the right focus and training in a particular area, but you know, we can deal with them. So, I don't know whether that answers your question.
Just slightly.
There is your response, Mike.
Can I just add something to that? In terms of being part of the safe group, there's a number of teams that sit together. One of the teams from the council that sits with that team, not only the defending team, the antisocial behaviour team, but also the CAF team sit there. So the common assessment framework function happens as a coordinated offer that takes into consideration the work that's happening with the police. So the youngster, 15, 16 year old, may have found themselves at the police's door, but there'll be a family that operates around that youngster. Are they younger siblings? Are they open to a team around the family? Are they open to social care? What interventions are currently going in? And as a result of the information that we've got, how can we work smarter, differently, and more integrated? And that's kind of a very early phase of what we're doing. The concept of framework team have been in there for a few months ago. So the sharing of data and information, intelligence, all happens as a natural course of events during the day-to-day work.
Which is what we saw when we went to MASH. Yes. Yes. We went to MASH, which was really interesting.
Next up is an update on the improvement plan, which will be introduced by
See you tomorrow.
Okay, so we've just given you an update on what's happened over the last couple of months since we last met. I wanted to just quickly go through a few quick updates since the last meeting in June. At the last meeting in June, I think we pulled a reference that they were looking to recruit very quickly to a director of children's services. The final appointment date was the 22nd of August, following the recruitment process during the summer, which saw Paul Boyce, who is currently the director of children's services in Knowsley, was offered and subject to usual checks as access to the post. I think that the date for Paul to start, we're looking at the end of the year, so about the 4th of December. And I'm saying kind of, well, maybe, because I think there will be official notification comes out about that, but that's the date that is currently being shared. We're heavily into the council budget setting process, and obviously everything that we're doing is feeding into that in terms of looking to prepare and plan for children's services going forward next year. So that's taking up quite a lot of time, energy, and trying to get the ambition right for children. I think there's been quite a lot of work in terms of children and people's overview of the scrutiny committee. It was a joint workshop with the local safeguarding board, and I know that reality is it's a report that will be reported later by the chair and currently underway. And the work programme is very much aligned to the improvement journey, and I think that that's very important to know, both from an officer and our young people's perspective. And what we're looking to currently plan is a programme of elected member training, and we will do that through organisation development and the right people at the base. There's been a number of training programmes that's taken place over the year, and we feel that we need to move into a more coordinated approach to that, so it can be planned into it at times ahead of schedule. And I've got some glasses back on, so not bad at all. Sorry. Okay. Something else that's kept us pretty busy during the last month has been the monitoring visit to the local authority. As a result of being in an adequate authority that's very well documented following the inspection in July last year, there will be regular monitoring visits by Ofsted. So Ofsted will come out about once a quarter. So they'll usually do at least 4 visits in a year, and they're under inspection conditions. So they usually have a week to prepare, and then they will spend 2 days on site, and that will be with 2 or 3 inspectors, and that there'll also be a quality assurance inspector. Following the visit to the site, there will be a process of moderation that is currently taking place for us now, and we should get that report published that came to us for factual accuracy check-in last week by the end of this week, as I understand. Simone, my colleague, is nodding because she's probably much more familiar with this, having come from Ofsted still quite recently. It was a really good couple of days, and Ofsted looked at 3 areas predominantly. You almost do give the keys to the electronic bank, and they can take this hands off wherever they want to, and they will follow and they will track leads picked up through children's cases or from what they've heard from staff during that visit. But the 3 areas that they came out to look at, the main area was our care leavers. People will recall when we set off on this journey that there was some issue around us not being able to clearly identify where all our care leavers were at that time, and that care leavers didn't necessarily have the right pathway plans in place, which is a transition into adulthood planning. If we're not in contact and we're not sure where they are, we won't have a meaningful plan. We've since established a new care leaver service, so we've reinvigorated the service that was there and we've put in additional capacity to that service. We now know where all of our care leavers are, and we are actively engaged with all but one of our care leavers, is my understanding, and of course that is subject to change depending on relationships. The young person that won't engage with us, we know where he is, he's not happy that we know where he is, he's all also not happy when we follow him or try and track him down, just in the same way as parents you would do if you didn't know where your youngster was. And when you find them and you don't like where they are, that you push back and you question why they are where they are and what they're up to. So he's not a happy young chap in our relationship with him, but we know where he is. Most of our young care leavers live in suitable accommodation, and that's another big move forward. I say most, there are a small number of those who are currently either in the Youth Offenders Institute or are in prison. We don't see that as suitable accommodation, but we do know that the young people are, and we are in touch with them in a meaningful and on a regular occurrence. The new Kelly services hit the ground running, and Ofsted told us that it was a very energetic, enthusiastic and passionate service. Those aren't words that Ofsted use lightly, really, so you kind of take it that Ofsted speak is usually quite measured and quite bland, usually, but they were, I'm choosing my words perfectly, so I can't. But they were very clear that this was a service, they loved spending time at the service and were very excited about some of the ways and the creative ways that staff are engaging with our young people. We say creative, there's all sorts of things goes on in terms of trying to hook those youngsters in and keep them actively engaged with us. And it is a team that brings to the table a lot of creative ways of working, a lot of skill and abilities to engage our young people. There are a number of people, it's a bit of a mixed team, and I'm just remembering as I'm thinking through this, because the team does have social workers on it. They're not appointed as social workers, but some of the staff that are social work trained. There's also a teacher on there. I think really, really important to note, there are also two care leavers that are employed and work with our care leavers. They're all educated to a level 3 social skills. So these are people that have been to college and followed their own career pathways and have chosen a job as in our care leaver service. We planned the design of the service with our young people, and those were some of the things that they told us were important to them. And they also recruited those staff with us, so they've been busy themselves being involved in establishing and setting up the service, from writing the job descriptions to looking at what they were looking for from the staff, and then going on to recruit those staff. I have invited Ian, who's sitting at the back, wave Ian, who heads up some of the teams that this team sits in, just in case there are any questions in terms of what you want to know from that. Okay, other areas that were looked at by the inspectors were the auditing process, auditing cases. We've taken a new approach to auditing children's cases, in that we are training all managers to be able to audit cases, with the intention that all staff are trained and can audit cases. And there's a real reason for that. First of all, it's picking up and knowing when a case is good, when there's been good work happened in that case. But they know how to continue the work with that person if they are picking that up, objectively looking at the developments or otherwise in a case, and not reading and making assumptions, but starting from the basis of being able to move that in person forward and to put right very, very quickly things that may not be in the case that should be in the case. So it's a very clear look and process at case file auditing and management. Ofsted agreed with us that the new approach that we put in place is probably the best